Hello students, I am Dr. Geetu Gambhir. Today I bring you the next learning episode in BSc Forensic Sciences on an important unit of the paper titled Technological Methods in Forensic Science, that is mass spectroscopy. In this lecture, you will be studying about the mass spectroscopy and its basic principle, components of mass spectrometer, how the interpretation of mass spectra is done and the application of mass spectroscopy in forensic science. Lastly, we will wind up this module with the conclusion. In the module 1, we'll be talking about the introduction. Module 2 follows with the basic principle of mass spectroscopy, components of mass spectrometer, and interpretation of mass spectra in the modules 3 and 4, followed by the application of mass spectroscopy in the forensic science in the module 5, conclusion in module 6. In the last two lectures, you have studied about the atomic absorption and emission spectroscopy. We also know that these instrumental techniques hold a specific position in the field of forensic science. This is because majority of the evidences needs to be properly analyzed and examined with the purpose of ascertaining their identification, that is, whether they are from the same source or not. Similarly, mass spectrometry is an impressive analytical technique used for the identification and quantification of wide range of chemicals and biochemical compounds. This technique is subtle enough to detect minor mass changes in the compounds, allowing for their structural elucidation. In mass spectrometry, the molecules are converted to their gaseous phase ions and separated on the basis of their mass to charge ratio. The ions move towards the detector under the effect of magnetic and electrical field and get segregated as per their mass to charge ratio. The result is achieved in the form of mass spectrum, which represents the relative abundance versus mass to charge ratio of a sample. The ionization methods used frequently for majority of biochemical analysis are electrospray ionization, commonly represented as ESI, and matrix assisted laser desorption ionization, which is MALDI. Both negatively as well as positively charged sample ions can be created using most of the ionization methods. Students, we will now study about the basic principle on which the technique of mass spectroscopy is based. The analyte molecules are converted to gaseous phase and bombarded with the high speed electrons so that they are ionized. These ions are separated in space or time based on their mass to charge ratio and are quantified. All the ions are accelerated across the same distance by same force, therefore have same kinetic energy determined by the acceleration voltage of the instrument V and the charge of the ion Z. As shown in the given formula, kinetic energy is the product of charge and the voltage of the instrument, also given by half mv square, where m is the mass of the ion and v the velocity of ion. As moved through the magnetic field, they are bent in an arc to follow a circular path of certain radius in the direction perpendicular to the applied magnetic field. Here, the magnetic force FH on the ion is balanced by the centripetal force FC and is given as FH as the product of charge, velocity of the ion, and the magnetic field. Also, the centripetal force represented by
mv square by r. Rearranging the above equation, the velocity of the ion can be represented as the ratio of the product of h, z and r upon m. The rearrangement further gives kinetic energy as mv square upon 2 and the charge to mass ratio as h square r square upon 2v, or radius of the arc is represented as 1 upon the product of h and square root of 2mv by z.
The ions of a certain mass to charge ratio value have a unique path radius, which can be determined if both magnetic field H and the acceleration voltage V are held constant. All ions having same m by z value are deflected to the same degree and follow the same trajectory. We now are aware of the techniques of mass spectroscopy and its basic principle, and will move on to the next section, which comprises of the various components of mass spectrometer. The major components of a mass spectrometer are: sample inlet. The gaseous phase sample ions are introduced into the ionization source of the instrument through the sample inlet. Common methods for sample introduction is direct vapor inlet, in which the high vapor pressure gas phase sample is introduced directly into the source region through a needle valve. Supposing the analyte decomposes at a high temperature, meaning that it is thermally labile or that the sample does not have an adequate vapor pressure, then it must directly be ionized from the condensed phase. The sample can also be introduced to the ionization source through a chromatographic system such as coupled high pressure liquid chromatography, also commonly termed as HPLC, or gas chromatography termed as GC instrument. Ionization source: the sample molecules are excited so that they eject an electron to form a radical cation, or are forced to undergo ion molecule reactions to produce adduct ions like MH plus, mostly by addition of a proton like H plus to a molecule M. The amount of fragmentation is controlled by substantial ionization energy observed in the mass spectrum. It offers structural information for the identification of unknown compounds in spite of the complications produced in the mass spectrum due to extensive fragmentation. Some ionization methods are easy and only produce molecular ions. Other techniques, known as hard ionization techniques, are very active and cause ions to undergo extensive fragmentation. The ionization method to be used depends upon the type of sample under investigation and mass spectrometer which is available. For gas phase ionization, the two suitable techniques are chemical ionization and electron ionization. For the ionization of the condensed phase samples, various techniques used are matrix assisted laser desorption, secondary ion mass spectrometry, fast atom bombardment and electrospray. Analyzers: the ions are accelerated into mass analyzer with the help of an electric field immediately after their formation. Resolving the ions which are formed in the ionization source according to their mass to charge ratio is the major function of mass analyzer. These mass analyzers have different features, including the range of mass to charge ratio analyzed, the mass accuracy, detection limits, resolution and scan rates. Analyzers can be considered as continuous or pulsed. A specific single mass to charge ratio is transferred to the detector by the continuous analyzers, and by scanning the analyzer, mass spectrum is required such that varied mass to charge ratio ions are detected. These analyzers consist of quadrupole filters and magnetic sectors. These analyzers work on single ion monitoring, which improves the signal to noise ratio. Pulsed mass analyzers collect an entire mass spectrum from single pulse of the ions. Since all the ions are detected, these analyzers have very high transmission efficiency, which increases the S by N ratio. Pulsed analyzers include time of flight, ion cyclotron resonance, and quadrupole ion trap mass spectrometers. There is a variation between compatibility of the different ionization methods and different analyzers. For instance, all the analyzers listed above can be used in combination with the electrospray ionization, whereas, for instance, MALDI is usually coupled to a TOF analyzer. Tandem mass spectrometers consisting of two mass analyzers have been developed for sophisticated structural and sequencing studies of complex macromolecules like proteins. In these instruments, the first analyzer is used as mass filter to isolate a molecular ion that will enter the collision cell where it is fragmented. The second mass analyzer analyzes the resulting fragments, measuring their molecular mass. Commonly coupled tandem mass spectrometers include quadrupole, quadrupole magnetic sector quadrupole, and the quadrupole time of flight analyzers. Ion detectors. The ions sorted by the analyzer strike the detector, where the signals are amplified and transmitted to the data system. For the generation of mass spectrum, the mass to charge ratio values of the ions are plotted against their intensities, which present molecular mass of each component, number of components, and the relative abundance of the various components in the sample. Common detectors used in mass spectrometers are the photomultiplier tube, the electron multiplier tube, and the micro channel plate detectors and Faraday cup. High vacuum system. Since mass spectrometers use gas phase ions for the analysis, they operate in the high vacuum system, typically 10 to 2 to 10 to 5 Pascals, often maintained by a pumping system. The ionization source, analyzer, and detector of the mass spectrometer are maintained under high vacuum so that the ions travel smoothly through the analyzer to the detector without any hindrance. This also minimizes the chance of collision of ions with the other molecules so that they do not react, scatter, or fragment. The figure shows the various components of the mass spectrometer to how the sample is introduced through the sample inlet and interacts with the ion source. The accelerated electrons interact with the mass analyzer, where they get converted in the mass to charge ratio and is subsequently detected by the detector as summarized in the ray diagram. Analyzing the peaks, a mass spectrum is presented as a bar graph in which the relative abundance of the ions taken on the ordinate is plotted against the mass to charge ratio taken on the abscisa. Most of the ions made in the mass spectrometer have a single charge. So, the mass to charge value is equal to mass itself. Modern mass spectrometers provide totally accurate values regarding the molecular mass of the compound by easily resolving ions which differ even by a single atomic mass unit. Molecular ion peak or the parent peak, the molecular ion is the easily identified as the ion with the highest M by Z value, unless it represents an impurity or an isotopic ion. The parent peak represents the mass of the molecular ion produced by the loss of an electron, that is M plus 1. Conventionally, it is used to calculate the molecular weight of the compound using the masses of the most abundant isotopes of all the elements present in it. It is often too weak to be seen in the high energy spectra that necessarily brings about the fragmentation of the molecule. The intensity of the molecular ion is high for the chemical stability of the molecule. Molecules containing P bonds tend to generate more stable ions. Therefore, the relative heights of the parent peaks of some class of organic compounds can be presumed to decrease in the following order: aromatic compounds, alicyclic compounds, ketones, amines, esters, ethers, carboxylic acids, and alcohols in the given series. Fragmentation and base peak. Due to bombardment with high energy electrons, molecules often undergo fragmentation, and thus the parent peak is either weak in intensity or is completely missing from the spectrum. The molecular ions are energetically unstable and some of them cleave into the smaller fragments. The most intense peak in the spectrum is the base peak, which refers to the ion with the greatest abundance, normally assigned as 100%. The heights of all the other peaks are measured with respect to the base peak. Cleavage is more likely to occur at the carbons exhibiting higher degree of branching and reflect the stability of the ion. The structural information about the molecule can be obtained from the fragmentation patterns of the mass spectrum. Isotope peaks. Many elements have more than one naturally occurring stable isotopes, which produce peaks in the mass spectrum other than the main peak, the one due to most abundant isotope. Molecules having heavy isotopes give peaks corresponding to their mass to charge values, that is peaks occurring at M plus 1 or M plus 2. The intensities of these peaks are relative to their natural abundance. For example, the isotopes of chlorine, 35 chlorine and 37 chlorine, occur in the abundance ratio of 75.8 to 24.2, and the peaks give the intensity ratio of 100:31.9. It has been already said that to prove or discern the identification of any evidence, instrumental techniques are usually applied in the field of forensics. In the same way, mass spectroscopy is also used in different branches of forensic sciences with the intent of analyzing the sample. Toxicological analysis. One area where the mass spectrometer is accessible is in the cases involving poisons or drugs. Forensic analyst can take samples of a subject's tissue or bodily fluids and determine if any toxic substance are present and if so, in what concentration. This can give vital clues to investigators as to how a victim died, as well as help identify the time and dosage of any poison or medication ingested. Investigators can also determine if a victim was a regular user of any substance that might have contributed to his or her death. Trace evidence mass spectrometry is also beneficial in examining trace evidence. Investigators at the crime scene may find microscopic materials like carpet fibers, glass splinters, or paint flakes. Ordinarily, these substances might be extremely difficult to use as a starting point to identify a suspect. However, a mass spectrometer can determine the precise mix of dyes used in the carpet fibers, the makeup of the materials that went into any particular glass fragment, and the precise set of polymers present in any paint sample. This information can lead investigators to a particular manufacturer who may be able to narrow down where a given sample came from, helping detectives to identify suspects and build a case. Arson investigations can also benefit from the use of mass spectrometry. While an arson investigator might be able to identify the use of an exclarant through burn patterns or lingering odors, a mass spectrometer can break down any residue and provide an accurate report of its molecular makeup. This can help identify any unique or exotic compounds that may be present. Discovering a similar mix used at multiple crime scenes may be useful for identifying the work of a serial arsonist. Explosive residue. Another area where spectrographic analysis is extremely useful is in analyzing the explosive residues. When a bomb detonates, it may not leave behind much of the physical evidence, perhaps only small fragments and chemical residues. However, commercial explosive manufacturers utilize their own unique mix of chemicals, and a spectrometer can analyze this residue to identify the particular makeup of the explosive involved. Even in the cases where a bomber used a homemade mix, the analysis may identify the type of materials used and give investigators a push in the right direction to identify the source. Mass spectrometry is an impressive analytical technique used for identification and quantification of wide range of chemical and biochemical compounds. The ionization techniques used frequently for majority of biochemical analysis are electrospray ionization and matrix-assisted laser desorption ionization. The gaseous phase sample ions are launched into the ionization source of the instrument through sample inlet. The mass to charge ratio values of the ions are plotted against their intensities to generate the mass spectrum, which shows the number of components in the sample, the molecular mass of each component, and the relative abundance of various components in the sample. Molecular ion peak is used to calculate the molecular weight of the compound. The most intense peak in the spectrum is the base peak, which refers to the ion with the greatest abundance assigned as 100%. With all these informations here, we come to an end of today's lecture. Do keep in mind what we discussed today. I will be back with one more lecture in this series. If you want to learn more and enhance your knowledge, you may log on to our website www.cec.nic.in for MCQ quizzes, LORs, etc. Thank you for your time today. I will see you in the next lecture. Have a great day.